There were just so many scientific discoveries this month, so as I said, I couldn't cram it all into a single 10 list, so here are 10 more interesting scientific discoveries for June of 2024. Number 10. Recycling concrete. We make a lot of cement these days and it basically becomes an artificial rock after a demolition. There are still ruins from the Roman Empire that were made out of cement, and they're still mostly there. Usually though, things can be reused and recycled after a demolition. Steel recycles easily, bricks can be reused, and so on. But with cement, it was unclear what could be done with a lot of it. It turns out cement can be recycled now, and it can be done with almost zero emissions. Production of cement actually is a huge contributor to greenhouse gases. About 7.5% of our emissions are from it. When creating cement, you need a material known as clinker that is made of limestone and clay heated to high temperature. Here though, researchers found that they could make a paste from ground up demolished cement from buildings and turn it into lime flux, which is then used in purifying recycled steel. The resultant slag from that process is clinker, which can then be used to make Portland cement for new concrete. If you can power the cycle using renewable energy such as solar or nuclear, then it becomes almost entirely emissions free, or at least drastically less. And it appears that the process can scale up to industrial levels. If it proves it can, then we actually have a really neat new way of getting rid of old concrete, smelting recycled steel, and making new concrete all rolled into one. Number 9. Ants learn faster when given caffeine. I admittedly am a caffeine junkie. I absolutely adore my coffee, as did my aunts, all 17 of them. Old school French Catholic family, folks. Anyway, it turns out that humanity's love affair and sometimes divorce with caffeine turns out to not actually be unique to us, and it's actually surprising in this case. So we're really large compared to the insects and can tolerate chemicals differently, but usually for the bugs, caffeine is a poison. Actually, a lot of psychoactive compounds in plants evolved as defense mechanisms, and certain ones, such as nicotine, are very good as pesticides. Bring in a new round of ants. These are much more numerous and of an insect nature. And caffeine for them, this usually is the case. It's a poison. But a controlled recent experiment using very small doses actually produced a similar effect in ants that caffeine has in humans. It caused them to learn faster and locate strategically placed sweet rewards faster than non-caffeinated ants. This was actually a complicated experiment involving control ants, and multiple doses to establish that they were in fact seeing the ants operating faster, and their efficiency really did improve with the drug. But only to a point. As the caffeine was increased, the effect increased, until it became comparable to an energy drink. Then it began to drop off, and doses became fatal at 2,000 parts per million. Number 8. The sun is convecting surprisingly shallowly. It's been thought for decades now that the sun's magnetic field extended deep into its interior. It works that way with Earth, for example. But with the sun, this was actually resting on an assumption. We just assumed it was deep, but no one actually knew for sure. What we do know is that the sun has a very strong magnetic field that is frankly astonishing in its power and can do things like bathe the Earth in coronal mass ejections. But it turns out that the sun's dynamo that creates the magnetic field may not actually be that deep at all. Indeed, it may be just below the surface of the sun. One question that was always present in this story was that the sun operates on an 11-year magnetic cycle, the infamous solar maximum and minimum. During the maximum, which we are currently very near, sunspots increase and so do coronal mass ejections, such as those weathered by Earth just weeks ago. The question was, though, how can all the phenomenon associated with a solar maximum be linked? We don't actually know everything about the sun, like much of astronomy. Our partial understanding does not account for everything happening in the sun, and indeed there are hints that certain things are going on in the big roiling mass that we aren't aware of. This makes it difficult to model the sun in great detail, nor is it clear how it creates a magnetic field. It turns out though that it may be created by unstable plasma rotating just under the surface of the sun. and that the magnetic field is actually being generated within the top 10% of the sun, rather than near the core. Interestingly, when the researchers at the University of Edinburgh under Jeffrey Vessel looked at the predictions their model made, they actually found evidence that that fit very well. So it seems the sun's dynamo is just beneath its surface. Number 7. Ancient armor worked. A big question about the ancient Greco-Roman world is how well some of the armor worked. It's always been obvious that some armor was very functional and protective, and there have been many experiments to that effect to see how effective they were. But some armor seemed more suited to looking impressive than actual functionality, something that was also done in Europe and around the world in the more recent past with parade armor, and in some cases that's still happening. Not much reason to go into battle though wearing a cuirass and a helmet with a plume these days, or for that matter a dress uniform. You go in with the Kevlar version of armor. But to look good, metal armor still works. But researchers in Greece wanted to find out how effective an unusually complete archaeological set of bronze armor known as the Dendra armor, which is Bronze Age, worked when used in battle conditions. And Greece's Hellenic Marines were happy to try it out with a replica set, and used it on a chariot, subjected it to spear, bow, sword, and even stone rock attacks. This was following Homeric descriptions of period battle tactics, and they actually did really detailed work following even the body temperature and heart rate of soldiers using this armor during intensive historical battle exercises, and they even ate a Bronze Age Mediterranean diet while doing this. The Dendra armor, which some researchers have suggested was entirely ceremonial, did in fact hold up in battle, though the soldiers said after spending hours in it, it was very fatiguing. Number 6. Humans are supposed to run. Humans are weird members of Earth's fountain of life, not just because of our intelligence and technology, but also the fact that we can run with unusual endurance. A human in really good shape can actually outdo a horse in endurance on average. Not speed so much, but as to being able to keep up running long distance, we can do it if in top shape. Our muscles really are evolved for stamina, and our method of dissipating heat, sweating, is basically supercharged. This has led to a somewhat contentious hypothesis that human physiology literally evolved for being able to chase down prey, and will not outdo them on speed, instead outdo them on endurance, and being able to tire the prey out. The reason this is contentious is because, well, we really don't do this anymore, at least according to previous viewpoints in anthropology, and haven't for a very long time. But that may be wrong. Human cultures worldwide have developed technologies from spears to bows to agriculture to facilitate hunting and food production, and it's almost universal. The simple fact is a human will invent and try to make their life easier. As an aside, Homo sapiens, the term, was coined by Linnaeus himself in 1735. The wise or sapient human. That's who we are, and he gave us our scientific name. The weird tidbit hidden in here, however, is that the only known specimen Linnaeus scientifically examined and wrote about from the species of Homo sapiens was himself. And he described the species from that. As a result, Carl Linnaeus isn't just any old Homo sapiens. He is the original scientific specimen of Homo sapiens to this day. So the need for endurance running gets more limited in the face of our huge sapient brains, and what they can do and have done across the world, leading to the question of if we ever needed the fast running ability in the first place, or did our hominid precursors have it, and did we simply inherit it from them, but no longer really need it with the big brain? New research made use of historical accounts from anthropology to take a fresh look and found that, yeah, people have valued endurance running worldwide, especially before 1750. And that it was a valued method of hunting and ability in many places in the world. It still is, it's a legitimate sport. And there are even accounts of not endurance hunting, but endurance herding of goats and other domesticated animals, strengthening the case that our evolutionary history was built not just for brains, but also endurance running. Number 5. Ancient mammals found that laid eggs. In the modern world, a very few mammals have the ability to lay eggs as a form of reproduction, basically the echidnas and the platypuses, but it may be that in the past there were far more species that could do this. And in a search of specimens collected in Australia decades ago, and then relegated to storage, three new species were found that are thought to be contemporary with the dinosaurs, with an age of about 100 million years. This actually brought the number of known species like this for this geologic formation from 3 to 6. Strangely enough, these mammal fossils are actually opalized, which can happen as a form of fossilization. This is actually related to a larger mystery. Just when did the echidnas and platypuses diverge from a common ancestor, and what was that ancestor? Still an open mystery, though it's suspected to have happened about 50 million years ago. Interestingly, however, one of the newly identified species, Opalios splendens, nicknamed the echidnapus, bears traits similar to both. In particular, the platypus, in that the fossil has structures very similar to the platypus that actually allow them to sense electrical currents in the water, helping them find prey. The ancient animal appears to also have been able to do this as well, but it also bore marked similarities to the echidnas, meaning that it seems to be something of a missing link, or at least represents a start as far as understanding the divergence. More work on this formation is planned, which very well could yield even more new species. Number 4. Orangutans practice herbal medicine. We all know that our fellow primates are smart. That's one of the things that we're known for. But it never ceases to surprise us just how smart the other primates are. Recently, a Sumatran orangutan was observed to have an injury on its face that it probably received in a fight with a rival. The researchers further observed that the orangutan actually started treating the wound with leaves from a plant. More, this plant is known to human medicine. The plant in question has anti-inflammatory and antibacterial properties, and has long been used locally by humans in the area, but also apparently the orangutans. The orangutan in question first chewed up the leaves into a paste, and then applied it to the wound, much like a bandage. The wound never became infected and healed at a faster rate than what you would normally see in nature. Animals using plants in a rudimentary way are commonly seen, but this is the first time when scientists have observed an animal in nature actually using a medicinal substance, anticipating a delayed result. One wonders how long the orangutans had been doing that, since they've been on this planet longer than we have. Maybe humans are not the first species on Earth to know of medicine. Number 3. Misplaced shark DNA. In yet another story from 100 million years ago, evidence has been found of a parasitic worm of a type that can infect species of fish and live in their digestive systems. This type of worm is similar to a modern flatworm, and this particular family is often found in sharks. But here's the kicker. It was found preserved in amber. In other words, tree sap. It's proving difficult for this specimen, which is well preserved and encased in amber from Myanmar, to be explained by paleontologists. It's simply in the wrong place for what it is, and it does not seem likely that even back then you'd find many sharks living in trees. The best guess so far is that there was a shark carcass on a nearby beach, and some scavenger feeding on it somewhere along the line flung a bit into the tree, where it was trapped in resin to later become amber. What would resolve this mystery is a fossil nearby from the host, like a shark tooth, and further examination of the find site. But it's possible we may never know how this weird fossil came to be. Number 2. More Pluto strangeness. One of the great discoveries regarding Pluto was its gigantic heart-shaped basin, Sputnik Planitia. This basin is rather odd for a planetary body, and it's thought to be the result of a very large impact. It's basically a depression on the surface of Pluto that's filled with frozen nitrogen. But with impacts this large, the impactor would have needed to be an asteroid larger than Vesta, and should have created an issue with Pluto's rotation. It should have caused it to wobble. And the basin should no longer be at the equator. In other words, Pluto should have a different tilt than it does as a result of this impact. Scientists did some modeling of impacts like this and concluded that Pluto actually could have formed a large, dense subsurface ocean. just under the heart-shaped basin that could still be persisting today, that counteracted the wobbling effect. But in more recent work, it turns out that it could actually have been far more violent. New modeling offers an alternative that Sputnik Planitia is indeed actually the result of a very violent impact, but no ocean was formed. Instead, the outer layer of the impactor itself was vaporized, but its heavy core remained intact, dug into Pluto, and is still there, giving the apparent anchoring effect. Number 1. Molecular science is getting very interesting indeed. This is actually a tale of two science news stories that show just how advanced our molecular science and engineering is getting. The first is simply known as Goldene. The future technology-minded know of graphene. Beautiful, sometimes perfect lattices of carbon atoms creating a substance already useful in many things, especially in science on tiny scales, but offers a way for very strong future materials that we would need for structures like space elevators and the like. Now, carbon's somewhat distant cousin gold has joined the fray. Here, something similar is done, but instead of carbon atoms, it's a lattice of gold atoms. While this is new, there are actually other atoms that can do it too, notably iron and phosphorus. With gold, however, the chemists made titanium gold carbide, and then etched away everything except the gold, leaving the lattice. In short, they were freeing the Goldene. The main takeaway here for this work is that this actually could prove to be really useful in electronics and chemistry overall, especially in that it means you have to use less gold in making electronics if you can make this work as a 2D, one atom thick layer of gold. The second discovery is creepy. In last month's list, I covered the generation of a Wigner crystal, and then interviewed Dr. Ali Yazdani from the team that did that work on Event Horizon, link below. The Wigner crystal was actually created between absolutely perfect sheets of graphene, and this beautiful lattice of pure electron matter resulted. I'm sure you'll agree that electrons are very useful things, and that ongoing research may be the very beginnings of a leap in unimagined future electrical technology. But the Wigner crystal was very ordered, and that made it somewhat creepy. But this month, there is another one. This one is the discovery of a molecule that actually is naturally occurring. Graphene actually might happen in nature as well, and we have been making it for centuries in tiny bits within pencil leads without knowing it. But here's another example of a fractal in nature. We already see fractals in nature, but this time it's happening on a protein. Found in the bacterium Senecoccus elongatus, the protein actually forms itself into a fractal called a Sierpinski triangle. Proteins within it can form up into triangles in water and can actually form complex, larger triangles. Synthesizing artificial fractals in chemistry has been going on for a while, but to see this one in nature is very interesting indeed. Behold. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing symmetries in chemistry suspiciously. You can't help but look at the perfect symmetries possible in nature and marvel at their beauty. But they also make you go, very odd indeed. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.